banana depletes the progesterone. So this slide shows, this is called the pregnenolone steal. And again, this is happening in the adrenal glands where we get that stress response. And you can see that the cholesterol is actually the foundation molecule for your hormones. So we need adequate fat. We need cholesterol made from fat. I was making a lamb roast today, and there's, you know, a lot of fat on a lamb roast. And my husband was saying, geez, that just looks like a heart attack when I look at that roast sitting there, because the fat's kind of melting off. And I said, you know, we don't get enough healthy saturated fat in our diet. We are solid at room temperature, and about 60 to 70% of our fat should be saturated, but we don't really have that in our diet. It's lean chicken, lean beef, lean turkey. So I said, actually, we need that for healthy hormones. And you know, what do I make a lamb roast once a month or something? It's not too much, because we do need that cholesterol. So the cholesterol makes pregnenolone, and then the pregnenolone can go to either make that progesterone and to make your estrogen. You can see how the arrows follow there. But if we're under stress, what happens is that progesterone gets shunted to make cortisol. So sustained stress lowers your progesterone load. Now you would say, oh yeah, but then you don't have enough to make estrogen either. However, we're also making estrogen in the ovaries and in our fat tissue. So we usually have, and the upregulation of estrogen in the fat tissue is it's going on when you're under stress. So we have plenty of estrogen, probably too much in response to stress, but our progesterone is being stolen to make that cortisol. So that's kind of what I'm talking about. Stress is depleting your progesterone and upregulating estrogen, again, exaggerating that estrogen dominance. So prolonged stress really is high estrogen. And the second paragraph talks about the other stress hormones, epinephrine, norepinephrine, cortisol, ACTH, that the body will make estrogen to try to quell those stress hormones as well. So it's not only, it's just has an impact on trying to quiet that stress reaction down. I bring this in, it might be a little more than you want to, but our perception of stress is where? It's in our thoughts. It is a perception, right? I mean, you look at a bill and your perception that, geez, am I going to have enough money? Or am I overspending? You know, jumping to what your check is going to be that month. That's a perception. You know, most of the time, you know, we just pay our bills and they eventually get paid and somehow we figure it out. But we're all wired a certain way. And it's usually a habit. The things that are our triggers for stress are usually a habit. It could be money, it could be your kids, it could be your health, it could be your husband or your wife. But, you know, we all have triggers. And the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland are in our brain designed to be sort of the first line of perception. And so our thoughts, conscious and unconscious, trigger those to then trigger that adrenal response, adrenaline and then cortisol. So a lot of times as a doctor, when part of the treatment plan will not just be getting your estrogen progesterone load, working on estrogen dominance, doing liver detox, changing your diet. It will also be trying to support these two glands, the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland, that are basically worn out. Because, you know, a lot of things have happened to us over our lifetimes. And the emotional, I guess, scars from that, or the emotional baggage from that, keep going with us. You know, there's ways to work on that, but a lot of time that's what's taking that toll, and that's why your treatments will be ineffective. You have to address that, for some people, you have to address that hypothalamus and pituitary glands. And of course, find ways to relax. Find ways to calm that down. For me and my breast cancer experience, that was one of the things I had to do. I had to find ways to show up at work and not have my armor on ready to go, sword in hand. You know, I was like, why do I do that? As soon as I get to work, I'm stressed out. I mean, I have the list going in my mind and trying to multitask. I mean, I have the same things to do every day, and there's a lot, but why do I have this attitude about it? I really had to work, I would say, for two, I still work at it, but I had to be conscious in my intention to do one thing at a time, you know, take a break at lunch. I mean, just calm myself down. And I would say, you know, just having the intention to it, maybe saying an affirmation about it every morning, I gradually have a different sort of energy when I'm at work. So it's better for me. I think I can be more present, but it definitely feels better in my body. I'm not so tired at the end of the day because I've made this choice to be calmer in the way I approach it. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. Hopefully we're doing good for time here. One other thing about estrogen detoxification, again, this is important because it has to do with a treatment approach or what you can do, is we can have good estrogen and bad estrogen. One of the things some women don't know is we have three types of estrogen, E1, E2, and E3. I guess I'm doing that backwards, E3, E2, and E1. You can see by the last part of the word, tri is three, di is two, and one is one, right? E1 and E2 are the stronger estrogens. When you're put on estrogen by a doctor or a naturopath, some naturopaths, E2 is usually the one they use. It's the strongest one. It makes things grow the most. Also has the most potential for risk. E3 is the most beneficial and actually is the greater part of our estrogens that we make. So it doesn't have that potential to make things grow as much. A lot of the bioidentical hormones I use are weighted more in the E3 than the E2, so less potential for risk. But there's also a problem when we break estrogen down in the body. And if the liver's functioning well, it has all the nutrients it needs to do that, we make several metabolites of estrogen that are actually almost like antioxidants, protect our tissue, don't have a very proliferative growth effect. But if your liver's under-functioning, you don't have the nutrients specifically that you need to degrade that estrogen, you create sort of two metabolites that are considered almost toxic. They are very proliferative. They damage DNA. They damage your cells. You can do urine tests to test for that if you're one of those persons. Sometimes that's done if you have breast cancer. That mostly they just want you to have no estrogen at all. But this is a little picture showing that estradiol and estrone, the two kind of stronger estrogens. If they go to the 2OH, estradiol, 2OH estrone, and the 2-methoxy, those are the ones that are good, you know, that aren't going to hurt you, they're going to actually protect you. But if your liver is faulty and under-functioning, you can make these 16OH and 4OH that are actually more carcinogenic and more toxic. So men have this, men have this same sort of scenario with testosterone. If testosterone is not degraded right, you create a metabolite, DHT, that is more growth promoting and creates the enlarged prostate and prostate cancer. So the herb that helps men help regulate that detoxification is saw palmetto. So maybe you're on a product like that, and my husband's been on it for like 10 years, but it's to protect you from the enlarged prostate and the prostate cancer, keeping degradation of testosterone healthy. Well, for women, what you want is, you know, all of these general supports to help with the two phases of detoxification in the liver, to eventually break down the molecule so it's water soluble, can be excreted through the gallbladder, the bile, and the feces, or the kidneys and urine. But you also need those cruciferous vegetables. I should have put a circle around that. The cruciferous vegetables, which I'll repeat again a little bit later, are really the magic food for women to help degrade estrogen, to keep those metabolites in that 2OH, that 2-hydroxy form. So the magic food for women perimenopause, PMS week. If you're generally just feeling out of sorts with your hormones, is start eating cooked cruciferous vegetables as often as you can. And it will really make a difference. Of course, some of the other liver supports like the milk thistle, burdock, globe artichoke. My product has some of these supports in it for the liver. And I put some of Marlene's products out. This isn't new information. A lot of people have this information. It's just not explained well to the general public as to why they would help and what they do. So part of what you're getting is hormones are not in isolation. They interact with one another. We have a lot of stress. Our cortisol is going through the roof. After a long, prolonged stress, now we have no cortisol, or the cortisol is becoming deficient. Our joints are starting to hurt because our natural anti-inflammatory support with cortisol is depleted. Our immune system, we're not fighting colds, we're not fighting cancer because our cortisol is depleted. Our hypothalamus is just like shut down, or, you know, randomly kicking out some feedback to the ovaries. So, you know, it's all working together. And, I had another little slide I wanted to show you. I think we've talked about most of this. But one of the things I want to show you is that stress, that high cortisol, eventually we start gaining weight. I talked about that a little bit, how you high cortisol, you start putting that weight on around the middle. And prolonged stress, again, wants to put this weight on the middle just to kind of preserve your vital organs so that the nutrients are preserved to keep those vital organs intact so they can function. But eventually, it has a negative impact on the insulin, on ovaries, parathyroid, pineal gland, and pituitary gland. And one of the things that, you know, your doctor will say, oh, you need to lose weight. Well, you know, it's really hard. You're under stress. You've gained this weight. Now your body's upregulating estrogen. You have more potential to make more estrogen to quell that stress response, that breakdown response. It's not easy to do that. That's really not even fair. It's almost cruel to tell women that without giving them some tools and some understanding about why it's happening and what's happening. But another thing that can happen when you eventually have gained so much weight is it reduces the sex-binding globulin, which is a protein that absorbs your binds to your estrogen to help you excrete it. But if you have less of that hormone, again, your potential to lose that weight is very limited. So again, what do you do? Start eating right. Start eating whole foods. Take out the processed food that really has no vital nutrients. We need to eat foods that repair our gut lining, that give us those proteins, vitamins, minerals, essential fatty acids that help repair the body. Do the liver support, get good sleep, and decrease your exposure to all those toxins. Let's see. The body's doing everything it can to preserve itself. I like to kind of reiterate that. When we get mad at our body and what's happening, we didn't do it on purpose, right? Our habits with food are habits. And again, once you're caught in that estrogen dominance weight gain cycle, you know, women stop, you know, most women who are trying to lose weight are really not eating very much. So it's true. There's a reason why that's happening. And if you can start understanding it, you know, that takes part of the stress away, that you're blaming yourself or you think you're doing something wrong. But you can start reversing this process that's happening. Resistance to hormones caused by high cortisol, this prolonged stress, it starts, I want to talk about the thyroid a little bit, but it starts creating resistance to a lot of your other hormones as well, including the thyroid, insulin, for example, and testosterone. Again, it's trying to preserve you. It doesn't want you to grow, or use up more nutrition. But I think this is kind of a good slide because you go into the doctor and, you know, you don't feel good, you have no energy, headaches, can't lose any weight. And he says, well, the good news is all your tests are negative. You know, you look just fine. And you know, how many have said there's got to be something wrong? I do not feel right in my body. Again, we're talking about how hormones are interacting. So hormones, a lot of the next big one for most women anyway, is the thyroid. Thyroid and cortisol have to be there in the cells, bound to their receptors at normal levels to work right. And too much cortisol over a long period of time will cause a tissue to no longer respond to thyroid hormone. Again, your body wants you to slow down. You know, take your foot off the gas, go rest, go take that 3-week vacation or 7 weeks, as somebody said, and I think it probably saved your life at the time. So, you know, we gotta back off. But what do? Give me some thyroid hormone. I'm sure if you just give me a little more, I'll feel better. My energy will pick up. And a lot of doctors do that, give you some, maybe even a low dose. And maybe it helps for a month or two, but then pretty soon you just feel the same. If you don't really feel it, because even though the hormones are, your body's not taking it up. So here's a picture of the thyroid gland. And you can see all the nutrients that the thyroid requires. Zinc, tyrosine, lots of iodine, vitamin C. And you can also see that what the thyroid gland creates is T4, which is the thyroid hormone bound to a protein so it can be carried in the blood to where it needs to be. For the thyroid to actually be used, however, you have to take that protein off. And to get to T3, to remove that protein requires progesterone and selenium. So when we're in estrogen dominance, our progesterone load is relatively low. That's part of the contribution why, even though your TSH and your thyroid looks fine, your numbers are perfect, you're not using that, or you're not getting the T3, the available T3, which then gives you the ability to burn calories for energy. Keep your body temperature, keep your energy for respiration. It's how you use calories. So again, those women who've gained a lot of weight, or even not that much, you know, 10 pounds, they're not eating very much, they can't lose the weight, but their stress is really high, then that's where, you know, your thyroid numbers look okay, but the body's saying, no, you know, your progesterone is insufficient and you've got, you know, that stress going too long. We're gonna do everything we can to keep that metabolic rate low so you preserve and don't use up the vital nutrients that you need for your heart, for your brain, etc. So, cortisol and thyroid at their respective receptors need an optimal level to work right. Persistent high cortisol will decrease that stimulating hormone and decrease the sensitivity to the TSH, which is your stimulating hormone coming from that pituitary gland. And remember, if you're under stress, that hypothalamus and pituitary gland can be dysregulated. And you need progesterone to get that free available T3. And persistent high cortisol level raises estrogen in an attempt to preserve the body. So you're getting this exaggeration again. A little bit about zinc and copper, just because a lot of people are taking supplements with zinc and copper. It's a little bit complicated to understand, but you want to think about zinc being related to your progesterone level and copper being related to your estrogen level. If they are out of balance, too much copper will exaggerate your estrogen dominance, and too little zinc will exaggerate your copper. I see people fairly often on zinc as a supplement by itself in a pretty high dose, like 15 to 25 milligrams a day, thinking it's good for their immune system or something, but they're not getting copper anywhere. So this becomes an issue when we're trying to get the hormones balanced. Women who are on a copper IUD, for example, or people who are exposed to copper cookware, sometimes you can have an exaggerated copper, which definitely exaggerates that estrogen dominance. So it's a kind of a subtle thing to look for, but it definitely impacts the hormones. And if a woman does go on an IUD with copper, you know, I talk about introducing a multi that has zinc, or making sure there's zinc in the supplement, that even a low dose, just enough to balance that. A high copper can also really exaggerate anxiety. So sometimes I'll do testing for those two, just to, you know, if it's not a hormone related, sometimes for mood disorders. And progesterone facilitates the action of the thyroid. Again, most women are a little deficient in progesterone. We need it for healthy thyroid and fat metabolism, to, you know, burn calories, to lose that fat. Aids in the retention of zinc. So that's kind of just breaking that down a little bit. I think we've talked about these two slides. But again, we want these images. How do we look and feel well? You've probably identified with some of the things I'm talking about, yourself diagnosing now, I have estrogen dominance, or, you know, I need liver detox. But really, have an image of how you want to feel, when you felt that way before. There is a way to find the balance. I mean, I help women find it all the time. And it often isn't that hard, and it doesn't take that long if somebody's committed to doing what they need to do. Again, I like to reiterate this slide because my sort of approach as a naturopath is to work on the underlying cause. So we want to work on maldigestion, we want to work on detoxification, talk about decreasing exposure to hormones outside the body, and of course that big stress cortisol picture. Healthy digestion, this is a little bit about what I talked about in my previous lecture. What we eat and how we digest it directly affects your liver and detoxification. Foods you cannot digest well disrupt the intestinal lining, and then you can't absorb the nutrients you need to heal and repair and fuel the liver and fuel those pathways to rebuild. But it also causes a big, it can cause a big toxic load in the blood. If we have so much damage to our intestinal lining, heartburn, indigestion, you know, we can develop signs of a leaky gut or inflammation on the gut lining. We see food proteins and then antibody complexes in the blood. That then becomes something the liver has to clean up. So again, those wheat and dairy are big food groups in our, you know, American diet that people eat on a regular basis that tend to cause and contribute to a leaky gut or gut inflammation, and thus an added burden to the liver. You get a leaky gut, you have liver stress, now it's overtaxed. Every day it's working on trying to clean up this food mess that's getting into the blood. It's also trying to take care of all those chemicals you're exposed, those creams you put on your skin, the fumes you're inhaling. You get food sensitivities, you get food allergy reactions, which then cause inflammation. You get nutrient deficiencies, a compromised gut lining, you can't absorb zinc, you can't absorb molybdenum, you can't absorb protein very well, and then you get bacterial imbalances, another stress to the immune system and digestive health. So healing the gut, improving the way you eat, 80% of the time when I do my detox classes and we eat whole foods for 3 weeks, people's sleep gets better, their hot flashes get better, their mental clarity, their mental emotional stability all get better in 3 weeks. It's amazing. And I've been doing these classes for, I don't know, Marilyn, how long? At least 10 years. Yeah, a long, probably 15 years. I do them 3 or 4 times a year. And I do them because it's so remarkable for people to see how they're eating and what an impact that has on their health, and also how easy it is to start reversing the stress that we put on our bodies that's causing these problems, especially with hormones. And I started doing those detox classes after I did my training on hormones and hormone balancing. She She said, if you don't have people do this, you know, you'll be using bioidentical hormones or a bunch of supplements, and you just won't get the results. So, but it's my telling you that, or it's your experience of it. It's your experience of it that's going to sell you. And, you know, nobody changes overnight. It took me a year to give up wheat. But I felt so much better when I didn't eat it. It finally wasn't worth it. I didn't want to feel sluggish in the afternoon. I didn't want to always feel bloated. You know, I felt so good. I had enough time where I wasn't eating it that I could feel the effect and could see the difference. So you need to, and probably a lot of you are, have that own experience for yourself to make it a lifestyle change. And of course, when I went to Europe, I ate everything. I mean, I pretty much gorged on pastries and pasta, dairy products, not gorged, but you know, if I have 2 servings a day, to me that's a lot because I don't usually have any. The quality of food in Europe is so much better. No GMO contamination, the grains are not hybridized, the dairy products only last a few days because they're not processed, you know, pasteurized and homogenized like we do here. The quality of food is so much better there that I just felt wonderful. I was, you know, hardly had any body pain. I didn't gain weight. So it's really what we're doing to our food. Again, a market like this is so such a resource for us to be able to shop and buy the kinds of foods that contribute to our health, not to our disease. So that's a huge, huge thing, to just start eating healthy foods and start understanding what those foods are. Overburden, underfunctioning, detoxification. You can see all the nutrients the liver needs. It needs B vitamins, folic acid, antioxidants, beta carotene, vitamin C, amino acids, the whole range of amino acids, a lot with sulfur. Cruciferous vegetables is in that category, again, to help that detoxification of estrogen in a healthy way. And whatever, when the liver actually reaches its capacity, when it's reached its capacity, you're eating, you know, a pizza or macaroni and cheese or quesadillas and, you know, wheat and dairy every day in your diet, and then you're putting, you know, those products on your body and a lot of just regular produce, not organic, at some point the liver will reach a capacity. And those toxins actually break your cells down, cause cell damage and DNA damage, which is important because if the DNA is damaged, then the cells start going haywire in how they divide. But when the body has reached its saturation point, what it does with those toxins it can't handle is it stores it in fat cells. Again, usually first around the liver, you know, under your right breast where your liver sits, and you'll start getting some fat accumulation of fatty liver, right? But then it just starts increasing, and pretty soon you have a couple rolls, and then you get a little bigger belly. And that is actually when you do a detox class where you start eating whole food for 3 weeks, that's where you start losing it. You start losing the toxins. And I tell that to people, it's not usually fat. It's usually inflammation in the gut and toxin accumulation. Again, don't be so hard on your body. It's doing everything it can to protect your brain, to protect your heart, to protect your breast. And this is just a reservoir for what it can't handle anymore. So, you know, if you think about that, how do we reverse that? You know, we have all of these things, the chronic stress, all the medications, the environment, what we're eating. So all those contributions that then take their toll on the liver and this accumulation of weight. So I don't know why these slides are a little out of it, but you know, again, the idea is reduce your load where you can. You know, I have filters on my sink coming out of the faucet in the kitchen. I have filters for chlorine on my shower. I buy almost all organic food now. I used to say buy some percentage of organic. I say now buy all organic if you can. Make it the exception when you don't. I remember Gary at work was talking, kind of, he thinks he's a doctor, my husband now, because he hears me do all this, and he was telling some woman at work that she said she couldn't afford organic apples for her kids, they're just too expensive, which you still hear that sometimes, organic food's too expensive, but he said, well, what's more expensive, chemotherapy or organic apples? I mean, really, can you afford it? You're going to pay for it now or you're going to pay for it later? And we are so lucky in the Northwest to have just volumes of fruit, and the price is going down. You know, Costco, you can buy organic food at Costco, you've got organic, and Marlene's prices are good for organic produce. I mean, I've shopped around, so buy organic as much as you can. Reduce that exposure. Buy your personal care products at a place like this. Marilyn, one of my patients, is doing a, you know, multi-level product for skincare. That's wonderful, mostly aloe vera based. Look around. Decrease your exposure to birth control. You know, I talk to a lot of young women about options for birth control, barrier methods instead of the pill. Once, you know, some of these hormones are really, have created some problems with hormones that can hardly be reversed. And they really can be dangerous, you know, and do the things you can with the healthy products you can get here to support your liver, juicing,